morning. My name is Jenny Morgan. I'm one of the co-pastors here at Highlands, and I get to welcome you with our ethos, which is kind of the statement that holds us together as a community. So whether you've been coming here for 2 years and 7 months, or whether this is your first time, we hope you find yourself in this ethos. Married, divorced, or single here, it's one family that mingles here. Conservative or liberal here, we've all got to give a little here. Big or small here, there's room for us all here. Doubt or believe here, we all can receive here. LGBTQ or straight here, there's no hate here. Woman or man here, everyone can here. Whatever your race here, for all of us grace here. In imitation of the ridiculous love Almighty God has for each of us and all of us, let us live in love without labels. Amen. Well, this week, we're almost halfway through Lent, our journey that leads us to Easter. Can we talk about Lent for just a minute? I won't ask for a show of hands, but I bet there are a lot of us in this room who remember Lent from childhood. It was a weird season, kind of a mysterious, misunderstood season filled with bad Friday night fish fries and an unbearable lack of sugar. Did any of you give up meat on Lent, on Fridays during Lent as a kid? Yeah, I bet quite a few of us did. And at the time, I didn't understand why we were substituting fish for meat one day a week for 6 weeks. At the time, we just did it. And almost everybody that I grew up with just did it. Also, if you felt guilty enough or holy enough, you'd give up chocolate or pop or television or something. It didn't really do any damage to me, so I'm not really complaining, but it also didn't give me any kind of spiritual awakening. I just couldn't wait for the Easter Bunny to arrive and end the lack of sugar that I had endured for 40 days and 40 nights. So on Resurrection Sunday, when he, the bunny, not the savior, finally came with an Easter basket full of chocolate bunnies and those little chocolate foiled eggs, well, Lent was finally over, and we'd then eat a big fat ham for dinner. So we moved from no meat and no sugar to an overdose of chocolate and a gross, salty slab of pork. That was Easter. That was Lent. And somewhere in the mix of it all, I think Jesus might have been raised from the dead, but I couldn't help being happy that Lent was just done and over with. Not just the Catholics, but lots of Christians endure Lent every year, secretly wondering, do I have to give something up again? Do I have to sacrifice something again? My friend Nadia has a different take on Lent altogether. She loves Lent because she loves the opportunity to talk about sin. She's one of the finest preachers I know, and she never uses Lent to make people feel like they're really bad. But she likes to celebrate the fact that we all sin and we all eventually die. I mean, she's right that Lent is the only Christian holiday where Hallmark hasn't co-opted it, right? Lent is, after all, about sin and how we deal with it and how we deal with its impact on our lives and on the world and even on God. Hallmark wants nothing to do with sin. I don't blame them. I mean, the whole thing feels like a downer. And many people, even in our church, experience Lent as a downer. But the psalm today tells a different story. It's Psalm 19. And David wrote it for the chief musician. It would be like somebody writing a psalm for Rachel McClare. And then the chief musician would sing it as a song, a poem with music. C.S. Lewis takes this to be the greatest poem of the entire 150 Psalms in the Bible. Lewis said, Psalm 19 is one of the greatest lyrics in all the world. Lewis, not really prone to exaggeration, just loved the poem. The structure, the words, the feeling the poem portrayed. It's almost like two poems, and then it's followed up with a musical coda. One poem is about nature, or what we might call creation. The second poem is about the law, or the Torah, and then it ends in a prayer. So before we read it, do you remember Robin Williams in Dead Poets Society? He was the teacher who urged his students to rip out the pages from the pompous essay on how to read a poem, and instead he encouraged them simply to read the poem. We do well to follow that advice today by daring to enter this world of a poem with our whole heart. Psalm 19, it declares three gifts from God: the gift of creation, the gift of the law, and the gift of forgiveness. Let's start with creation, nature. The heavens are declaring the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours forth speech, and night to night declares knowledge. There is no speech, and there are no words. Their voice is not heard, yet their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In the heavens, he has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom from his wedding canopy, like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heaven and its circuit to the end of them, and nothing is hid from its heat. Creation calls us to worship God, to hear God's voice in our sun and in our moon, in the heavens and the stars and the constellations, to hear God's voice in the entire sky and all of nature. Each day talks about God's glory to the next day, and every night shares its wonder and its knowledge of God with the next night. Creation can't use words like we understand words, but nature serves as a universal translator, so we can hear and see and feel and know God better. A voice sings to us, and the focus of that voice, of creation's voice, is the sun. The brilliance of its light and power and heat, nothing can hide from the sun. It is life and light for all of nature. The sun is inescapable. If the sun or a mountain or a whale or a constellation could speak to us, what would they say? Nature is really like another Bible. Maybe it's an easier Bible to read and understand than the one that sits on your nightstand. It's like living evidence, a living voice that God is good and God created a good world. And honestly, most of us have trouble hearing the voice of God, even during Lent. Pain or loss or horror in the world around us or in our own souls, it makes it hard to hear God. It makes it hard to trust that God is good. During Lent, we're instructed to make some sense of what it means to be a sinner in a sin-stained but awesome creation. So for those of us who doubt and those of us who fail at our Lenten offerings, this psalm gives us hope. I've heard many in our community who are struggling to keep their Lent commitments at this point, like giving up certain kinds of food, or beginning a new prayer practice, or physical exercise, or I've heard of people who are trying to offer up one random act of kindness every day. If you're like me, you've already lost track of how many times you've fallen short. And creation shouts above our failures and says, "Look at me. Isn't the world beautiful? Forget about your sins and your failures for just a minute." It's like Psalm 19 helps us take a break. Psalm 19 invites us into something new. That's how the poem begins. Creation points to the Creator and invites us to reconsider Lent and reconsider our relationship with God. Our kids over in that part of the building helped me with my own reconsideration of God. At least several of them in our children's soul care ministry are interrupting the teacher right now. Someone is carrying a toy snake or a picture of a pony, and these things are way more intriguing to him or her than the Bible story. It's not that they're uninterested in Jesus. They just happen to experience Jesus in the plastic python, right? They see God in creation, and they can't put it into theological words, but who cares, right? That's not the point. The point is they get it. There's a Celtic saying that says that heaven and earth are only 3 feet apart, and in thin places where we glimpse the glory of God, the distance between heaven and earth is even smaller. Lent provides us a thin place, a place to look and listen for the voice of God in the world, and yes, in snakes and ponies and even leprechauns. When I have felt lost or overwhelmed this week, the glory and the beauty of creation helped me. Rocks and trees and skies and seas. Nature has made me want to reconsider God. Maybe this psalm can help you too. I mean, do you think we could pull away from our cubicles and computer screens, our anxious conversations, and just notice creation? Notice nature, the natural world. This week, I want us all to try that noticing, because nature and creation is a gift, a Lenten gift from God to us. So what about the second gift, the law? To hear this part of the poem, I want to ask you to close your eyes, and rather than read it on the screen, I want you to just take it in as I recite the words to you. So go ahead and close your eyes. This is Psalm 19, again, to the chief musician, a psalm of David. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the drippings of the honeycomb. You can open your eyes now. The law calls us to see God and to desire to be faithful to God. I don't know about you, but I could understand this poem better if it were about God's mercy or God's visitation to our planet or about how much God loves the little children, but it's not. This part of the poem is actually talking about the law, the commandments. When I first read it, this part of the poem just pissed me off. Really. I mean, how can King David, the poet, be rejoicing about the laws as though the law could revive a broken heart or be desired like fine gold or sweet, pure honey? The law. Like the Ten Commandments and all that? Like the thou shalt nots? Prohibitions against clothing and food and sex? It's more like one writer's take on the commandments. Say what you will about those Ten Commandments, you must always come back to the very pleasant fact that there are only 10 of them. Psalm 19, the poet describes God's laws in positive, not punishing ways. What God wants us to do and who God wants us to be is actually simple and good and pure and rich and sweet and restorative. God's laws are trustworthy. At least that's what the poet thinks. And this Lent, I'm wondering, is law about obligatory duty or is law about sweet desire? Duty or desire? Like the lover who feels as though she has wounded her partner, and so out of duty, she buys a dozen beautiful roses, shows up on the doorstep, and says, "Because I am committed to you, and because God says I should always treat you with love and respect, it is my duty, my solemn duty today, to give you this beautiful bouquet of flowers. I hope you like it. I went to a lot of expense and even more hassle to fulfill my duty to you." So the offender, the one bringing the flowers, self-righteously feels she should do this thing, and when she does, she feels good about herself. The experience of the one receiving the flowers, at best, it's sad and lonely. It's the shoulds that often get in the way of love. Is that what law is about? Is that what Lent is about? Determining the shoulds with God and then executing our duty. Remember the searching and cleansing sun from the first part of the poem? That now translates into the voice of the law, searching and cleansing the deepest parts of us, like the sun reaches into the deepest corners of the earth. In praising the law, the poet actually points to something bigger than rules and regulations. The law points to God. The loving Creator is revealed not only in creation, but also in the law. The perfect law lights our way to the perfectly loving God. For our Jewish brothers and sisters, the Torah was a way of life based in love that found expression in a right relationship with God, a delightful, satisfying, sweet relationship with God. The law is spelled out precisely in the Bible, and nowhere more precisely than in Leviticus, a book written long before the book of Psalms. Even in that ancient, ancient text, the law of God is summarized within the context of relationships. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. Then the law is referenced repeatedly throughout the New Testament. Remember when Jesus said, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than this." Then later in the book of Romans, the writer interprets Leviticus and Jesus and says this: the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandments are summed up in this word: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfillment of the law. So, in spite of my pissed offness and our propensity to focus on the shoulds of the law, as it turns out, the law, like love, is not based in duty. It's based in desire. Like the partner who feels love-struck after 23 years of life together. So much so that out of the blue, on a Monday morning, for no reason other than sustained passion and gratitude, she buys a dozen roses and shows up on the doorstep and says, "Because I am madly in love with you, and because the gift of you to me is the most joyful part of my life, it is my deepest desire today to give you this beautiful bouquet of flowers. I hope you like it." The lover who gives those roses is offering something that we all long for. And the recipient of those roses feels what most of us wish we could feel: intimacy, safety, like a love that is constantly reaching out for us. Like a relationship, to quote our psalm, that is more to be desired than gold, even much fine gold. Also, sweeter than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Same roses, right? Same beautiful roses. One bouquet is out of duty, and one is out of desire. I mean, which would you prefer to get? And which would you prefer to give? That's what the law is supposed to be about. The law of love. This is the place where all of God's laws lead, whether in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, or in the 21st century. The law of love always trumps duty, obligation, and shoulds. The law of love always trumps duty, obligation, and any sense of should. And the law of the Lord is perfect. It does revive the soul. It is pure, and it endures forever. I see the imprint of God's law most clearly on the cross. Jesus wanted to come and find us. Jesus, who paved the way for the law of love, who demonstrated the love of God by wanting to be with us in our poverty, in our sin, in our pain, and even in the glory of being a human. Jesus actually helps me want to obey the laws of God. Jesus, who is the Creator, joined us here within this beautiful, broken creation so that we could have yet another second chance to see God in the face of Christ. Jesus Christ, who died in order to give us ears to hear the fullness of God in creation, in the law, and on the cross. So when I feel lost in Lent, the law as desire, not as duty, makes me want to reconsider God and reconsider Lent. So what about that musical coda at the end of the poem? Let's look at that for just a second. Moreover, by them, by the laws, is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. But who can detect their error? Clear me from hidden faults. Keep back your servant also from proud thoughts. Do not let them have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Psalm 19 and Lent calls us again to reflect deeply, with or without giving up meat, chocolate, or whatever. The call is deep reflection. The poet talks directly to God now, not just about God, not just about creation and the law which point to God. The poet talks to God. And the poem ends by dealing with sin. The sin we know about in our lives and the sin that we don't yet know about in our lives. Sins that we're very well aware of and sins that we harbor in a way that makes us even unaware of what we're doing. The coda is about spiritual awareness. It's about forgiveness. And it is time to deal with ourselves as sinners. How do we face our sin without making ourselves feel like dirt? How do we face the fact that we need more than just a positive self-esteem? We need more than just a positive self-image. We human beings carry a great burden, and we need more than the ability to manage our sin and manage what we might think of as the bad parts of us. When we are most honest, we know we need Lent. Most honest. It kind of describes a tool that small group leaders like our Deepen groups and pastors use to help people understand how to take steps toward positive, appropriate vulnerability with others. So honest is the level of a relationship where you're truthful about the facts. More honest is the level where we identify our feelings connected to some fact. And most honest is where we learn to identify our part or our responsibility in our life situation and admit our frailty, our brokenness, our sin to someone else. Lent asks us to be most honest. Lent teaches us that we are in bondage to sin. We're tangled up in self-interest and we can't help it. We're lost. Our pissed offness with God is only one reflection of wanting to control our lives. And damned be God, it's so easy to feel that way. The irony is, we try to hide our sin from ourselves, from God, from other people. And Lent calls us out. Lent offers us freedom. During Lent, we have the opportunity to be most honest. We have like a new chance to admit our secret sins, the ones that we're aware of, the ones that we're not aware of. God wants us to be cleansed from our rebellion. God wants us to be free. And Lent, in spite of being about sin, is not primarily about a list of prohibitions. Lent keeping is about the gentle discipline of making time and space for God to speak and for us to listen. Time and space for God to speak and for us to listen. Lent helps us own our faults and then joyfully expect Jesus Christ to wipe the slate clean, because that's just what he does. Jesus wipes the slate clean out of desire, not out of a sense of duty. Now, I'm not quite ready to say with my friend Nadia that I like preaching about sin. Nor do I understand all the mysteries of Lent. But Psalm 19 has helped me. It's helped me to enter into the marvel and the imagination and nature during Lent. Psalm 19 helps us to hear and see God better. When we're lost, we can turn to this psalm, to gifts from God, like God's Lenten offering to us, noticing creation, being aware of the law as desire, not duty, and forgiveness that we find in Christ. So enter the music of the spheres and the music of God's loving law and just listen. Lent listening. It's slow and it's gentle and it's forgiving. I'm going to ask you to listen now to a short paraphrase of a small portion of the poem. It's a paraphrase by Eugene Peterson, and it'll serve as our prayer today. You can read the whole thing later. It's actually in your program, and I thought you might like to have it. You can take it on a walk later this week, or you can read a couple verses of it every day as a way to begin over again and reconsider Lent. If you listen, you may just hear God in the rustling grass in your backyard. You might hear God whispering, "Hey, look at me. I forgive you." Let's pray. God's glory is on tour in the skies. God craft on exhibit across the horizon. Madam Day holds classes every morning. Professor Knight lectures each evening. Their words aren't heard. Their voices aren't recorded. But their silence fills the earth. Unspoken truth is spoken everywhere. God makes a huge dome for the sun, a superdome. The morning sun's a new husband leaping from his honeymoon bed. The day-breaking sun, an athlete racing to the tape. That's how God's word vaults across the skies from sunrise to sunset, melting ice, scorching deserts, warming our hearts to faith. Clean the slate, O God, so we can start today fresh. Keep us from stupid sins, from thinking we can take over your work. Then we can start today, sun-washed, scrubbed clean of the grime of sin. To you we lift up our lives, God, beloved of our souls. Amen.
And I'll run after you. and down.